We'll start with our study. We were in the book of Revelation, chapter 17. And last time we finished till verses 1 to verse 6 in chapter 17. And we saw four things in chapter 17. We looked at the mystery Babylon. We looked at her character, we identified her character, we identified her team, we identified her work and her purpose, we identified her clear title. Now it's very important that we understand as we go through this chapter that the Word of God is true. And not only the Word of God is true, the judgments that the Word of God is showing is absolutely true. And is going to come to pass. And the reason we need to understand these images, that no matter how scary these images to us would look like, but these are going to happen. That's number one that we need to understand. Number two, even in all of this gore, in all of this blood, we need to understand that God will keep his children. And all of this that God is doing it for his children. That his children can stay away from seduction. We discussed last time that this woman seduces, and every person who wants to come and look at this cup of this woman can only find abominations inside that cup. Worldliness is a very easy way for the church to get entangled. Horatius Bonar said something like this, and I quote from him. He says, I looked for the church and I found it in the world. I looked for the world and I found it in the church. It's important that we understand that the sin of worldliness, it's very easy for the church to get entangled in this. And none from us can say we are safe from it. Remember James telling us, and John repeating it, that we should not love the world. And this world is represented here by John as a prostitute city. Not only is it just a prostitute, it's a mother of all prostitutes. This seduction takes people away from God. So this is not just sexual sin, but rather from this image of promiscuousness of the woman playing the harlot, the deceptive nature of every idea that takes us away from God. The primary thing is the riches, the wealth, the goodness that those things will give us leads people to idolatry. We also should understand the way John describes. She is not only the harlot, she is the mother of all harlots. So you need to understand that every time someone fell into lust, every time someone bowed to some other god than the real God, this whore has been active right from the beginning. Revelation 17:6 reads like this, and I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. The world was always persecuted the church. She not only strives to kill the church, but it's through that worldliness that where the persecution would be less, the worldliness would be more. In fact, persecution, I can tell you, is identifiable, so it could be less dangerous. But worldliness is not something that people would easily agree to as a problem. That beauty, that charm, makes us think that it's not, and it's far from the bloodthirsty nature that God is showing to us in the scriptures. And we also saw that she is not alone. She's always with the seemingly ubiquitous beast. It's an omnipresent beast all the time, as it were, which has that violent power that helps her. And he's there every place. It's as if the beast is helping the woman and the woman is helping the beast. You need to understand that the beast is there every time. And so the mother of Odams is with the beast. And let's see what we're gonna come to today. We're gonna see the team of the beast more personified. Let's read from verse 17 or 6 onwards. Chapter 17, verse 6 onwards. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. Verse 7. And the angel said unto me, wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman and the beast that carried her, which had the 7 heads and the 10 horns. The beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was and is not and yet is. And here is the mind which hath wisdom. The 7 heads are the 7 mountains on which the woman sitteth. Verse 10. And there are 7 kings, 5 are fallen, 1 is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the 8th and is of the 7th and goeth into perdition. And the 10 horns which thou sawest are 10 kings, which have received not kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings for 1 hour with the beast. These have one mind, shall give their power and strength unto the beast. They shall make war with the Lamb, and with the Lamb shall overcome them. For he is the Lord of lords, the King of kings, and they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. And he said unto me, the waters which thou sawest, where the whore sitteth, are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. As you read through this portion of scripture, I know many of you would have been worried about certain passages inside that. And as we go through this difficult passage, let's all pray in our hearts that God gives us wisdom to understand the entire passage. You remember what happened to John when this chapter started? The angel told him that come up hither, and even if he was taken to the wilderness, and in the wilderness he saw this whore, this deceptive woman who wants the entire world to follow her and with her follow the beast. Now, we spoke about last time, why wilderness? But one of the reasons we need to also understand the wilderness is only from the wilderness experience sometimes it's easier to deceive. It's easier to see and lust for something that you do not have. Remember Matthew chapter 4? Jesus' temptation? Jesus is led by the Spirit into the wilderness. You remember that? And then the devil tempts him, takes him on top of the high mountain and shows him all the kingdoms of the world and says, all this he can have. He just has to fall down and worship Satan. And the Lord says, you shall worship the Lord thy God only, and him only you shall serve. What was the devil telling him? You worship me and all of this is yours. And was the Lord telling him, I don't care whether these things belong to me. It actually did. But the matter was, you shall only worship your Lord, your God. That is the devil's strategy. That is the woman's strategy. It shows you the world. And when your interest gets mingled with the world's interest, it will ruin the purpose for which God created you. If you always keep trying to flirt with the world, if you think a little more does not hurt us, is there any sin? You would not know where the compromise starts. Let me tell you, the best of us cannot stay away from the lure, from the deception of the beast. The best of us. You don't believe me? Read the verse. I saw, Revelation 17 verse 6, and I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. What was John expecting to see? He was told that, come with me, I'll show you a prostitute. And I told you the word prostitute is referred to a low-level woman, a low-level whore. John expected the whore to be standing for judgment, almost at the point of death. But now when he looks at her, it does not look like a woman who's in poverty, who's wretched. Rather, she's adorned in scarlet and purple. She's adorned in gold. Instead of her being struggling, she's drinking from a golden goblet. So much so is the entire view. It's so marvelous. Even the apostle cannot stop admiring that woman. In fact, if you look at the Greek, it's like, I wondered with great wonder. It's the same word used again. It's a word which is used in verse 8 also. If you remember, they that dwell on the earth shall wonder. Who dwell on the earth? The sinners. It's the same term used. So John here is admiring that woman who's supposed to be hated. If it was not for the grace of God, none of us would be saved. None of us can escape the allure of the world. Not even John. Look at what happened. And the angel said unto me, wherefore dost thou marvel? He is immediately chided. Oh, John, what's happening to you? I'll tell you the mystery of this beast, the woman, and the beast that carries her. And I just told you she's going to go into judgment. How can you admire and marvel something that's going to die? The beast is real, my friends. Let's not ever think it's not. Even the apostle couldn't stop admiring if God would not have stopped. Flirting with the world is always going to land us up in trouble. Just a little will take us too far. But let's look at what the angel says. Angel says, why are you marveling at this? I'll tell you of the mystery of the woman and the beast that carried her, which has the seven heads and 10 horns. Now you'll find this very interesting, that the angel does not talk simply about the woman. The mystery are not two mysteries. It's mystery. It's singular. It's mystery of the woman and of the beast. Why? Because as we understood last time, the woman and the beast are in some senses inseparable. Wherever the woman is going to go, the beast is going to be there. In fact, the major portion of this chapter, you'll see, we're going to be discussing the mystery of the beast, the judgment of the beast, almost till verse 15. And next time, we'll see the judgment of the woman. So there are no two mysteries, there's one. So the end of the woman is tied to the end of the beast, and the end of the beast is tied to the end of the woman. That's gonna, and the final is gonna be at the final end of the world. Both of them work together. Both of them will die together. It's a perfect marriage. And look at what else does John see. Verse 7. I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints. It's not only the beast who's drinking the blood of the saints. It's also the woman. Can this imply that the saints were wounded by being deceived by the woman? Yes, it can. We understood James telling us the very thing. It can also mean the woman will work the beast to attack the saints. But both ways, brothers, please understand, the world is always going to be against you. Always. Let's just forget this idea that there would be a time when the world will accept us, because somewhere down the line we believe the world is good. It is not. It is sinful. And anyone who is washed by the blood of the Lamb, anyone who is called as a saint, the world will only try to kill the saints, to drink its blood. For John, it should have been a repulsive scene, isn't it? You remember the way Jews thought about drinking blood? It was seriously not allowed. But here, a woman that drinks blood is still marvelous, even for someone like John, who has to be controlled by the angel. Idolatry is tied to all of us. In fact, in this very book, John accidentally lands up trying to worship an angel. And the angel has to tell John, don't do it. I'm like you. I'm a fellow servant. Idolatry is tied into our hearts. And the more we try to find out the reasons for why we work, why we study, why we want our children to study, why we want a good health, we'll understand where we are standing in this temptation about the world. Now let's look at the description of the beast. Verse 7 says, the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carried her, which had the 7 heads and 10 horns. You remember this creature, don't you? The creature that came from the sea, and we spoke about this last time, what we call as the Antichrist. But let's look at the description even further. Verse 8, the beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition, and they that dwell on the earth shall wander, whose names are not written in the book of life and from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was and is not and yet is. The beast that sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit. Does this term sound familiar to you? Can you turn with me to Revelation chapter 1 verse 4? Revelation chapter 1 verse 4. John, to the 7 churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace from him. Now listen carefully. Which is, and which was, and which is to come. Which is, which was, and which is to come. Revelation 2, verse 8. Revelation 2, verse 8. And unto the angel of the church in Smyrna write, these things saith the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. Now let's go back and see the beast. What does it say about the beast? The beast thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out and shall come. Do you see what we spoke about the beast earlier? This is a parody, a caricature of the Lord Jesus. That's what the Antichrist is. The book of Revelation always refers to Jesus' eternality with this. And here, they're trying to mimic the same thing that the beast was. And then he gets a wound. He feels as if he is dead. And then after some time, he'll descend out of the bottomless pit. And then he will go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wander. Now remember what I told you. Who the beast was. We said the beast is like the son of the devil. The devil, the red dragon, the ancient serpent, the Antichrist, the beast from the sea, and the false prophet, all three, we said, form a false trinity to mimic the true God. Now keep your finger here on Revelation 17:8 and turn to Revelation 20. Revelation 20. And I want you to see something. Revelation 20, verse 1. And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold of the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan. Wait for a second there. Whom did the angel caught hold of? The dragon, the old serpent, which is the devil and Satan. Meaning, he was. The devil was there. Then, what happened? Let's read on. And bound him for 1,000 years. Meaning, now he is not. When he bound him, what happened? Verse 3. And cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more. So the entire time, he is not. The ancient serpent was. Then he was bound that he is not. Then you see, till the 1,000 years shall be fulfilled, that he should be loosened a little season later. Then he will ascend again. To be finally, we read in the book that he is put into the lake of fire for final destruction. Can you see the comparison? The beast that you sawest, Revelation 17:8, was, is not, shall ascend out of the bottomless pit, then go into final perdition. And the sinners on the earth, when they see all of this scene, they shall wonder. They shall be amazed at the beast. Who will be amazed at the beast? Whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world. When they behold the beast that was and is not and yet is, they have not seen his death. But they would see that he was before. There was a time when it seemed that he is dead, but now he has come back again. And they are marveled at him. The same thing that's going to happen to the beast is just a mirror of what's happening to his father, the devil. And the earth dwellers are not able to withstand this deception. Why? Because the names have not been written in the book of life. Brothers, if you and me can ever fight deception, it's not because you and me are intellectually brilliant. No, no, we are all sinful. It's not because you and me are smarter, or you and me pray more, or you and me go to church more. It's not because you have a better church. It's not because you've got a better pastor. It's not because you've got a better family or brethren around you. No. If you are withheld from any form of deception, it's because your name is written in the book of life from the foundation of the world. If any glory goes to you not being deceived, the glory goes to God alone. Someone asked me this question today. That in the time of the virus, will the people in the charismatic churches see the foolishness that they do with their fake healings, with their false prophets and their pastors? My answer was easy. If God opens their eyes, they will. But just because judgment is there, just because death is there, just because failure to heal is around, does not mean they will repent. They can only be deceived even more. And everyone who is deceived is deceived because his name is not written in the book of life. The protection for us comes from the Lamb. The protection is of the protection of the book. Let's look what else John is told. Revelation 17, verse 9. And here is the mind which hath wisdom. The seven heads are the seven mountains on which the woman sitteth. You see that phrase there? Here is the mind which hath wisdom. Did you not find that similar verse when you're looking at the number of the beast? If you have wisdom, if God gives you the wisdom, you will recognize the beast. If you have wisdom, you will recognize Babylon. You will recognize the beast. The insight is the wisdom that God gives to people. The wisdom that Daniel got, that Joseph got. That even in the midst of Babylon, God protects. Now look at the identity again. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth. Seven mountains. Last time we said that the first century people can easily mistake this for Rome, because we said Rome was actually a city that was fit on seven mountains, or seven hills rather, not mountains. Here it mentions mountains. And though figuratively they would be looking at Rome right now, because Rome is the one which is a mixture of Babylon, which is a mixture of the Antichrist, which is a mixture of the dragon that they can see. But we've always seen that the imagery in the book of Revelation goes beyond their immediate need. And this mountains are not simply Rome. In fact, Revelation chapter 20, we understood something, that every island and mountain fled away. And at that time, we understood that that's the idea there, that God is creating a new heaven and a new earth. But what do you mean here that the seven heads are seven mountains? on which the woman sitteth. I hope you understand this when you've read through your Bibles. So many times in the Bible, you would have read that mountains in the Bible are referred to great kings and great kingdoms. Brothers, I really hope that when we run through this list of verses, the way you look at many of the Psalms and many of the portions from Scripture will change dramatically. Turn with me to Zechariah chapter 4. Zechariah chapter 4. Verse 7. Who art thou, a great mountain before Zerubbabel? Thou shalt become a plain, and it shall bring forth the headstone thereof with shoutings, crying, grace, grace unto it. Turn to Jeremiah 51, verse 25. Jeremiah 51, verse 25. Behold, I'm against thee, O destroying mountain. That's to Babylon, saith the Lord, which destroyeth all the earth. I will stretch out mine hand upon thee and roll thee down from the rocks and will make thee a burnt mountain. This is not a physical mountain. It's a kingdom. It's a king that he's saying, I'm going to destroy you. Jeremiah 51, verse 25. Jeremiah 51, verse 25. Turn with me to Isaiah 40. Isaiah 40, verse 3 and 4. This is a familiar passage. The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness. Who said this? Of course, John the Baptist. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make straight ye in the desert a highway for our God. Each valley shall be exalted, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough places plain. Isaiah 64, verses 1 to 3. Oh, that thou wouldest rend the heavens, that they wouldst come down, and the mountains might flow down at thy presence. Verse 3 says, when thou didst terrible things which we looked not for, thou camest down and the mountains flowed down at thy presence. And you can even turn to Daniel 2, 34 and 35. Daniel 34, 34 and 35. Thou sawest till the stone was cut out with our hands, which smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay, and break them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold broken to pieces together and became like the chaff of the summer threshing floors. And the wind carried them away, and no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. You would recognize the great mountain. Habakkuk 3:6. Habakkuk 3:6. You can also read Haggai 2, 6 and 9, Matthew 21, 21, Luke 3, 5. I'll read Habakkuk 3, 6 for you, just for the shortage of time. He stood and measured the earth. He beheld and drove asunder the nations, and the everlasting mountains were scattered. The perpetual hills did bow. His ways are everlasting. The mountains bowed down. The mountains were scattered. So what is John trying to tell us? He's saying the seven heads are seven mountains. But he does not stop there. He's using the same head to describe it one more thing. Look at the next verse. The seven heads, and they are seven kings. First, he said the seven heads are what? Seven mountains. Now, what is he saying? The seven heads are the seven kings. Five are fallen, one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. The seven heads are what? The seven kings. Five are fallen, one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. If not from the very words, at least by the way I read it, you would have understood the connection with this, with what you read earlier about the beast. Who was, who's not, and who is to come. This again is a reference to the same beast. It almost as if saying, five kings have already gone. One is right now. And in a short period of time, he will not be there. And then he will come back. But when he comes back, he'll only be there for a short time, a short space. He's repeating the same imagery again and again so that we don't miss the beast. So that five which have fallen, referring to the same beast, there'll be time when he is not, there'll be time when he comes back, but the time that he comes back will be a short period of time. And as if the imagery is not complete, he goes on, verse 11. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth and is of the seven and goeth into perdition. I want you to be a little focused here. This can be a little confusing for the way the words have been written. But I think you should be able to solve it by now. And the beast that was and is not. So the beast was there till now. He's not there anymore. That blow will be such that people will think the beast is dead. He will come back. And they will think he's the eighth. He's new. But in actuality, he's the same seventh one who will finally go into eternal hellfire, into perdition. You see the same imagery of the beast. The same beast whose head is wounded and people will think he's dead is now shown to us from a different angle. You shouldn't miss the beast. Brothers, the numbers are only to indicate us, as you see in the book of Revelation, that the numbers are there to explain to us the imagery well. It's apocalyptic literature. In fact, the idea of seven and eight was something which in the Hebrew idiom is also a type of a numerical saying. It's a graded numerical saying. When you want to include everything together, you use two consecutive numbers in parallel to show that the entire list is exhaustive. What you see here is the exhaustive list of all the kingdoms of the beast. You can turn with me to understand this graded numerical system, like the two numbers given parallelly. If you look at Proverbs 6:16, some of you might remember this verse. There are six things which the Lord hates. Yes, seven, which are abomination to him. Meaning all of that that the Lord hates, six and seven, it's all together. You can turn to Micah 5:5. You'll find this in a lot of passages in scripture, which says something like this. Seven shepherds and eight leaders of men. Seven shepherds. Who's a shepherd? He's a leader. Seven and eight. It's like sometimes we say, how many people were there? Seven or eight. It's just to put all of them together. It's a complete totality of people shown from those parallel numbers. Just so that I give you a little bit more of the information. I just do not want you to get confused, and but just so that in ancient Greek, the numbers 888 or the number 8 would many times be used to show Jesus Christ. So similar, so the way people thought 666 stands for Nero or stands for the beast, many people from the Greek numberings thought 888 stands for Jesus. The point that I'm trying to make is, so some have identified this as, if you read that verse, he acts like the eighth, but he's actually the seventh. The world will think he is the eighth. He is Jesus, but is actually the seventh. But we can keep with the standard way the scripture explains to us that when the beast dies, he comes back again. To rule the people. It just shows the final climactic destructions of all evil kingdoms are coming together. But John still does not stop there. You might be thinking, John, enough, we get the point. But John does not stop. He goes on. Verse 12. And the 10 horns which thou sawest are 10 kings, which have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. Now, just as a sidebar, if you have been reading dispensational literature, people are divided between Israel and the church. They tell you Israel is different and the church are different. They see the European Union here. They say these are the 10 countries, 10 kings in European Union. They'll come together and they'll make establishment. They'll fight against the Lord. That's not true. The European Union today, I think, has got 27 members. I think England is out, so it's got 27 members. So what does 10 indicate? We have understood this all the time. In the Bible, what does 10 indicate? Completeness. In fact, if you read that verse clearly, how does it tell you? The 10 horns which thou sowest are 10 kings, which have received no kingdom as yet. Now, isn't that strange? You saw 10 kings. Each king should have a kingdom, right? But the text says they do not have a kingdom. Meaning, what? All of these kings wanted to rule over the earth. They wanted to rule over God's people. And so the complete complement of all these kings together have given their power to the beast. And together, all of them will attack God's people at the last hour. You can see the time. It's a short time. It's just 1 hour. Why 1 hour? Because the Greeks and the Romans didn't divide their time into minutes and seconds and nanoseconds. For them, the shortest module of time, because their sundial and their watch pieces, would the shortest period of time that they would show would be an hour. So the 10 horns, the 10 kings, will give their power to the beast so that along with the beast, they could at least, as it were, rule for an hour. Why an hour? Because God will cut short that period for us. But look at their singular mind. They have one mind. Verse 13. They shall give their power and their strength unto the beast. Remember, we spoke about this even earlier. Herod and Pontius Pilate. Be it fascism or be it communism, does not matter. Be it a democratic country, be it Republicans or be it Democrats, it's easier for them to come when they have one mind. Because they have only one enemy. And that is the Christian. Because the Christian worships the Lamb. They give their power and their strength to the beast, and they shall make war with the Lamb. Beloved brethren, even with a group of people who are going to, at the end, strip each other naked, eat each other's flesh, they still have one mind. But look at the Christian church. Look at the people who follow the Lord. They still can't come to one mind. And what is the reason that John and James ascribe to it? It's because of the very lust of the flesh, the very lust of the eyes, the very pride that does not allow you to have one mind, and you constantly bicker and fight among each other. Babylon seems to be a lot more united at times, right? And trust me, it is. Babylon is much more powerful, much more stronger, much more organized. But even in all of that, we win. You know why we win? Because we really fight hard, right? No. Verse 14. They shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them. For he is Lord of lords and he is King of kings. The Lamb had a bunch of people with him who had harps in their hands. They were not warriors. They were not fighters. The war was not won because they fought, not even once. If the war is won, and the war will be won, it's because the Lamb, the Lord of Lords, the King of Kings, who has called his people chosen and faithful, he will overcome them. My dear people, the promises of the Bible are true. Every word that's given in this book of prophecy will come true. Sinners will be judged. Babylon will be killed. But none of that is because we lifted a finger to fight. It completely disheartens me when people show that this fight belongs to them, that they can do things, they can fight the devil, they can bind it. Have you seen the stupidity of them? When people struggle with addiction and people think that they on their own can do it, or their self-help groups can do it, when people think that they can continue their salvation. If the Lord does not fight, if the Lord does not chide, we would all be marveling at the beast. How much do you think a life you will live understanding this reality? Where do you find yourself calling out names to Satan? We have people who want to pronounce arresting Satan and binding him. None of that should be obvious to you by now. Works. Believers have to be in one mind. because they belong to the Lamb. Let me ask you, after what we read today, do you see the promises in the Bible would always be true? Do you see the nations will attack us? And we read about this even earlier, that the beast captures them, overpowers them. But do we pray that we should be overpowered, not in seduction? Do we pray, Lord, let that be violent? I don't mind. But let me not at any moment, Lord, do anything that shows that I'm seduced by this whore. Let the time comes when I would have to be burnt at stake like so many people before us. Let me have that smile on our face that he has chosen us worthy for all of this. Our harps are not going to win our battles. But our harps will be used to sing the victory song for the Lamb. Babylon will fall. The beast will die. We just need to know. Whether if we have to pay a price for that by being any part of the beast. The last verse we have read through. And he saith unto me, the waters which thou sawest, where the whore sitteth, are peoples and multitudes and nations and tongues. We are none of these. We are the ones who are called. We are ones who are chosen. We are the ones who are faithful. We'll be standing on that sea of glass. Beloved, if the study today has troubled you, I would ask you to cheer up. To know that the Lord will win. If the study has moved you to understand and check how much we are working with that Babylon, and if that has led to godly sorrow, I'll pray that God will move you to repentance as sons. And for the people who think that Babylon will continue, Babylon will win, we have news for you, which God willing will see in the coming time. Let's look to God in prayer. Father, Master, we thank your Holy Spirit for explaining words that at times look so difficult for us to understand. But it's your Spirit alone, your word alone that teaches. Your word alone that clarifies, that your word alone removes every darkness, every fog. And we thank you, Master, that your word, your spirit has shown us the light. Thank you for the time, O God. Thank you for the few people who joined. Thank you for the struggle that they're going to understand, and we believe that you would teach them in your time. Most importantly, Lord, thank you for warning us that flirting with the world will only lead us to destruction. Thank you, God. Help us, Lord, to join and sing always for the Lamb. In his name we offer this prayer. Amen.